warm welcome. You're watching Education News Network, and today we're bringing to you a fresh new topic of discussion, that is redefining school leadership during the pandemic. And for that, we have with us a panel of eminent educators who will be joining us in this discussion today. So let's welcome our first panelist of the day. We have Mr. Desmond DeMonte, principal of Sri Lanka Medical School, Dehradun. We welcome you, sir. Thank you for being
Thank
here.
Thank you.
Our next panelist is Mr. A.S. Gangwar, the principal of Delhi Public School, Jharkhand. Welcome, sir.
Thank you.
We then have Mr. Gopal Kaushik, the principal of H.G. International School, Rajasthan. Welcome, sir.
Thank you. Thank you.
Our next panelist is Dr. Sandeep Khanna, the principal of MIT VGS, Pune. Welcome, sir.
Thank you.
We then have Mrs. Josephine Anthony, the principal of Athena Global School, Chennai. Welcome, ma'am.
Thank you, Nitya.
So to discuss our topic of discussion, may I please invite our first panelist, Mr. Desmond DeMonte, to speak on the topic, please.
Good afternoon, everyone. And it gives me a great honor and privilege to be speaking on the topic, redefining school leadership during pandemic. As leaders, we have to look at this topic very carefully. It talks about school leadership and redefining it during the pandemic session. Now, we all know that from the last 1.5 years, the schools were actually disrupted due to the pandemic. Around the 24th of March last year, we got the notice for school closure. As a school leader, many of us were confounded at that time as exactly what we should be doing. We at Sri Ram Centennial School decided by the 29th of March itself to start with online classes. Prior to that, we had various discussions whether to use Google Classroom or whether to use Seesaw. And finally, we decided on Google Classroom and to use our ERP. The process continued, and by the 21st of April, we found that the schools were not going to reopen again because lockdown 2 was announced. It was at that point we decided to switch to a more interactive process by using Zoom, because Zoom was an easier platform. We could use the 40-minute free version. We had a lot of brainstorming on this. We had teachers being trained, because we had to keep in mind that what kind of staff we had. Some were good at technology, some were not. We tried to keep it a bit flexible, whereas some other schools decided to close for summer holidays and they would start early. But as a leader, we had to navigate our plan. And so it was very important that we had to relook and redefine what our roles would be. So if you see, as a school leader, what was our mindset? This was very important. So as a school leader, I did feel challenged at that time. And we had to think out of the box, because we were dealing with a problem that was quite new and unprecedented. As a leader, we had to navigate a different course. But while navigating the different course, we had to keep in mind what would be the path that we would choose. And now, as a fan follower of soccer, I would like to take the example of a football match as Euro 2021 is on. As a school leader, we are like the captain or the coach. We have the management over there. We have to sit down, we have to discuss, and then we share our plans with the team members. As a school leader, while redefining what our role would be, we realized that the goals were the same. The goals for students to do well, to be well-rounded citizens. These plans were in the process. Now, the only difference would be that we would have to modify and reorganize the schooling, because it would be through the online mode. As a school leader, we knew that our aim was to see that our children have the holistic and experiential learning. So this is the success that we were planning through the online process. Then as a leader, it was very important that we had to relook at the background of our institution. What was the demography of it? What kind of parents were we having? What kind of staff did we have? Are they tech savvy? Would they welcome the new technology and the online classes that we were planning? Again, as a school leader, we had to see whether we are privately owned, whether we are government aided, whether we are being run by a trust or by a society, because that is a defining moment in the decisions that you take. If you're government aided, naturally you'll have a lot of lack of infrastructure, lack of proper support in most cases. In private, you're further guided by your management. It all depends upon what kind of freedom you're given in running the institution. Then I also had to look at the competency level of the staff. How many were tech savvy? How many would be comfortable learning it? What would be the process of training those who have a handicap with technology? We also had to look at the infrastructure support. Was the school ready? Were staff at home prepared for the online classes? So all these things were really, really very important and kept at our forefront. As a school leader, it was also very important that I understand my own strengths and weaknesses. I had to see whether I'm good at technology, whether I'm abreast with the latest happenings. So it gave me a continuous process of involvement. It was not like a 9-to-4 job or a 9-to-5 job. This was a 24/7 job. So when we were redefining the role of a school leader became 24/7. We were just thinking about evolving new methods. And also, when we are not in the offline mode, how do we restructure our organization? Do we delegate powers and responsibilities? As a school leader, when we are redefining our leadership role, it is very important that we are prepared for the pros and the cons. So if school is reopening, what do we plan? If schools do not reopen, how do we plan it? So if schools reopen, we'll have to see the challenge of social distancing. We'll have to see intensive cleaning, thermal screening. We'll have to see proper supervision of movement of students around the school. We'll also have to have a good medical support tie up with hospitals. We'll have to have classroom management of staff and students. Do we run schools in shifts, in alternate days? How do we complete our syllabus? What kind of technology would we use in the classroom and for students who don't come to school? How do we deal and convince parents who do not wish to send the kids to school? In the same way, if schools reopen, if schools do not reopen, what kind of timetable would you have? How would you deal with the digital divide? How would you give feedback for assignments? How would you conduct assessments? How would you deal with open book examination? How would you supervise your classroom that the team is working towards the goals, the mission and mission of the school? How do we prepare for board examination? How do we get students to get motivated to attend all the classes, to turn on the videos, to assist the teachers in the transactions of the lessons? And also, very important, how to deal with parents who complain about online screen time. So these are the important things. If schools reopen, what kind of infrastructure support do we have for our staff? Many of them have started good teaching practices using online mode. So we need to continue to support them. We have to see that the staff are safe and healthy also, because many of them are 40, 45 plus, 50. Also, we have to keep in mind the emotional support that needs to be provided to the students and to the staff. We have to increase the number of counselors. I was just watching the news, and there's so many helplines coming up for students, for elderly citizens. We have this Nimhans counseling from Bangalore offering counseling sessions. We have the Ministry for Women and Child Development offering helpline sessions. So the role of counselors become all the more very important. We also need to train teachers to be good counselors, because we all have to be equipped to handle this. Children, when they come back to school, what kind of fitness program do we run? Because COVID-19 is not moving away in the next 1 or 2 years. We are already aware that the third wave has broken out in Africa. So in case school reopens, how do we deal? Then you have the pressure from government. You have to deal with a number of circulars, number of orders, and also the media and print. They are always waiting to find something, you know, whether it's regarding fees, whether how we run the school. So there's a lot of pressure. And if schools do not reopen, how do we continue the training of our staff? How do we have time for students to connect with one another? So we should have circle time. I'm planning to incorporate in my timetable a period where children can interact with one another, with their class teachers, talk about what all they are doing. So there is a connect. We also have phone-in counselors when students are not coming to school. We also have online fitness program because many children are growing obese. And we continue to handle pressure about fees-related, media-related issues and how we can deal with it. As a school leader, we want to be successful. We have to have a clear vision about where we are taking our school. We have to develop a strong team. We have to manage our people, and we have to see that resilience is built in all of us, because this is a very important time where a lot of us are losing our self-confidence. So resilience is very important. As school leaders, we are constantly rethinking and remodifying our teaching practices to help our students. We also get professional support to deal with a lot of anxiety, frustration, and other emotional needs. We are constantly telling our teachers to look at all the digital support that the government is providing, that the NCERT is providing in Nishtha, in Diksha training, in Gyan Darshan. We are also taking our parents into confidence. We are constantly building with them. We need to get parents of professional backgrounds to talk to children about the various opportunities available. We have a lot of communication happening across the board. We send newsletters, we send updates. And for the teachers, we are keeping it flexible. So those teachers who need help, we have a group mentor also who helps them with technology, with building up new processes of teaching learning to make teaching more effective. And we are working with the development of staff. Also, as a school leader, we are now delegating responsibilities to our student council also. I've involved them. We have various online opportunities where we are participating. So we are training our students also to be responsible for all these programs. So to conclude, a school leader, we are defined by a determination, by a hope, by a vision. And we should have that unshakable belief that what we are doing is for the best interest of our students. As a school leader, we are the coach and the captain. Every day is a new match. So every day you have to think out of the box about the new strategies that you're going to employ. As school leaders, we need to act swiftly, because that's very important. And the decisions that we take, we have to be considerable about it, so that we are aware of the consequences of our actions. Remember, as school leaders, we do not have any previous manual for the day-to-day challenges that you're going to face. There is no R&D as of now present to deal with this unprecedented situation. So we need to form a network of principals, of school leaders who interact with each other and share good practices. And as school leaders, we should constantly attend seminars, webinars, like those which are being organized by Education Today, where a lot of positive sharing and discussion takes place. So with this, I would like to conclude that as leaders, we should be firm in our belief, because when we think optimistically the team will move forward. Thank you.
Thank you, sir. Those are some really important points that you put forward. Thanks. So, Mr. A.S. Dhanwar, could we hear from you, please?
Good afternoon.
Good afternoon, sir.
I'm glad to be the part of this panel. And I think Mr. Desmond has point by point included each and everything. Nothing is left. In my humble opinion, nothing tests the true mettle of leadership than adversity. The COVID-19 pandemic is one of the deadliest challenges in human history. No nation, no sector, no industry has remained untouched by this catastrophic upheaval. Loss of lives, slowing economy, lockdown continues to ravage the world. But in this period of pandemic, the instances of leadership is what will impact the greater good of mankind in years to come. I believe the trait of rising above the ordinary in extraordinary times has redefined leadership in pandemic. Education, like other sectors, has faced a very difficult situation in this pandemic. But the online education platform has revolutionized the entire teaching learning process. The unprecedented coronavirus induced lockdown has been a life altering experience, not just for students, but teachers as well. Attending online classes from home has been challenging. Dynamic leaders around us acted as mentors who not only influenced and upgraded the technological skill of their team members, but were able to read and react to different individuals and situations. I think it has been the one bright silver lining to the dark clouds of COVID. They took this crisis as an opportunity to grow in achieving their goals by becoming the driving force of their organization. Navigating the challenges of uncertain educational environment and bringing a transform to digital learning is more collaborative and engaging approach that focuses on the empowerment of individuals and teams. As the pandemic continues to reshape the education system, the current trend indicates that digital learning will be an integral part of the post-COVID world. As per my experience, the traditional and conventional view of leadership of just being knowledgeable, having decision-making capacity, analytical ability, has now taken a transition to being visionary, adaptable, engaged, and humble. New leadership profile aims at growth with a vision and new approaches to understand the changing attitude and behavior of the student, staff, faculty, and program. The need of the hour is to use technology optimally and understand the rapid changes. As the world is heading towards the new normal, leaders are transforming to help their organizations innovate with the new age technologies to attain collective excellence. The EDU leaders are shouldering the responsibilities of keeping the moral compass steady while illuminating the lives of the young learners, while maintaining a balance between fast execution of technology and upholding humanity. Thus, we as leaders need to innovate ourselves by redefining our approach and being a driving force to our teams, organization, and to the entire world in the period of uncertainty. I am glad for initiatives like this, which help us to be prepared for better tomorrow. As challenges never come knocking our doors, but whenever it does, we must pick up the challenges and do whatever it takes to win over it. So Nitya, this is my holistic view on redefining leadership, and I would be glad to hear the views of other panelists so that we can recalibrate our pedagogy to give children the best learning experiences in this pandemic. Thank you.
Thank you, sir. Thank you for sharing your views. So, Mr. Gopal Kaushik, can we hear from you, please?
Good afternoon, everyone. It's a pleasure to be a part of this panel discussion. My greetings to all the eminent panelists. Most of the things, technical things, are already discussed and said by Mr. Desmond. I'll bring your attention to the something different. Yes, definitely this was unprecedented condition and the situation to the schools also, where we had to move with the physical classroom to the virtual classroom. It was a challenge to the teachers, students, and the parents also. First, as sir said earlier, lockdown was for the some limited time. 1 month, we were speculating like it was for 1 month, 2 months, and things will be resumed. And students and were also very reluctant when we initially called people to come and start with the online classroom. The first major challenge we faced, like how to train the teachers, as this was also point mentioned by Mr. Desmond, being our teachers, we developed our own app, which includes all the live session as well as online teaching and the documents, etc., examination pattern. But the problem was how to use it, reason the teachers are not available physically to train. And we need to train teachers first virtually, then the teachers will be training the children and guiding children further. So I appreciate our team, and we did with the collaboration and collaborative efforts and trained teachers, and teachers then performed accordingly very well. Second challenge was from a student side. First, how to train teachers. Second was from a children's side. Reason children, they went to the countryside where the infrastructure is not available for the internet. And if you go move on with the live class, then you need a good data speed, which is not available. Then how to move on? We saw the participation rate of our children. It was very less initially, 30%, 40% for the live classes. Then we moved with the booth system, online recorded videos and documents as well as with the live. Then the students had option, either they move on with the live or if they miss the live schedule, even then they are listening to the recorded videos of our teachers and they are moving further, which was, I think, a great feature of our starting with the online system. And as sir said, the screen time here, yes, parents earlier in initial phases were reluctant. Like the children, they are spending, I think, hours and hours in front of a mobile as well as into laptop or desktop, any system. There is one article published, one research paper published in the Elsevier journal. The topic is COVID-19, its impact on education, social life, and mental health of our students. They did a survey in detail. In that detailed survey, it is found that the average screen time of a child is 3.29 hours per day, where if you compare the school children, their screen time was 3.69 hours per day. It's on a higher side as compared to the college going kids as well as the university going kids. If we talk about the age group wise, they have mentioned 7 to 17 years, their screen time was 3.69 hours per day. The age group 18 to 22, their screen time was 2.98 hours per day, which is on a lower side. And it shows like the teaching, school teaching was more effective and acceptable by the kids as compared to the senior kids. And there is some satisfaction rate also on the basis of research, the people said. The school children, their satisfaction rate is on a higher side, that is a 33%. People only says it's not satisfied. Like 67% children, they are saying like they're happy with online teaching. It means school, they have evolved with the passage of time during this pandemic, which is great. But if we talk about the senior kids on this research, the 55% students are unhappy in the senior college as well as university level. It means schools, they evolve themselves in a better way as compared to the other frame of education in the country. I would like to bring the attention on a few how we moved on further. The first major challenge was it was a panic condition. How to keep your team calm? How to keep the students calm and parents also to know your concept. So if you are having that attitude, then you can make a decision what is correct, what is incorrect. So first was how to keep a people calm. That was the first challenge. And second was how to develop the confidence of your team. As the teachers, it was a new set for the teachers who are teaching from the past 10 years, 14 years in the classroom teaching setup. And now suddenly they are moving into the virtual setup. Then how to keep their morale high? So confidence, how to increase in the confidence of your team. Then third was communication. Yes, how to communication plays a major role, I think, in this online teaching learning process. If there is silence can allow many rumors to move on. And the communication make a bridge between the parents as well as the school authority, which was very, very important. And we started weekly feedback system. We started the fortnightly feedback system, which was, I think, a major landmark in our success of this online teaching last year. Then if we talk about further collaboration, yes, we are moving virtually. So collaboration without the solid teamwork, we cannot move on. So we had to develop faith in the teachers and whosoever are giving the good practice, we share the good practice of everyone, so we could make our system day by day more better and better and strengthen effective for the online teaching. Then come to the community. See, school is now open to the community through the online system. As teacher is teaching not only to the child, the parents are also witnessing, the member present at home also witnessing. Teachers, they have to be very careful what they are talking. They need to move with the prepared lesson plan. And the reason the child is not assessing, the parents are now assessing the teachers. That was also initial phases a major challenge. And the teachers who hesitate, there was a hesitation initially. A reason everyone is not having a camera, the people are having camera phobia also. That also we need to tackle with. So it was open to the community. And if we talk about the moral behavior of a school and the school staff also is on stake if we are not teaching online properly, if you are not going prepared. So that was also a major challenge. Then come to the compassion. As this is an unprecedented pandemic, we have to be a compassionate. CBSE is also on a compassionate ground, has called off the final examination as well as 10th and 12th. I think first time in a history, the board examinations are canceled on the compassion ground. So that is also one part. Then last and the very major point, what I'm talking about, the finance of the schools. There were many restrictions. The government also made a different guidelines. Different states had a different guidelines. And parents also, they had an economical crisis at the end. And the school, they faced a lot of financial crisis. Where a few schools, they cut off the 50%, 70% salary. As the sir said in his earlier slide also, there are different categories of a school. The most affected schools are the private schools and the unaided schools. And if the management is good enough, they help the schools. Otherwise, the schools, they have faced a lot of financial crisis also. So there is a variation in the quality. If we talk about the teaching and redefining school leadership, as the topic is very relevant, I appreciate the education today to discuss on this topic today. So these are a few points I just here say about this. Thank you, sir.
Thank you for sharing your views. Dr. Sandeep Khanna, can we hear your views on the topic, please?
Yeah, very good afternoon once again. So first of all, thank you so much, Education Today, to bring us together, all of us on a common platform and share our views and discuss something which is very relevant in today's time, that is redefining the school leadership during the pandemic. Fellow colleagues have already shared most of their thoughts and very less to be discussed. However, I will like to touch upon something different. Gopal sir said already that communication is the key. So yes, when it all started, you know, it takes me back to again March 2020 when we were not prepared and suddenly this lockdown was announced. And believe me, the teachers with a strong support of management, they were so quickly adapted, you know, to the new system. So on the exact 2nd of April, we could begin with our online sessions that was already scheduled on time. And gradually we moved on from Zoom to another very safe platform that was empty, Microsoft Teams. However, the teachers were not again ready because online education was never taken as a regular way of or method of teaching. It was always considered to be an emergency tool. So what happened, gradually we had to conduct a lot of sessions with the teachers, with the parents, as well as with the students. We conducted a lot of trainings during the summer break, in fact, on different topics. So gradually teachers were ready in the month of June with the new technology. So the key was adaptation to the new way of teaching. And then it moved on, and there was a month I remember in the month of December, January, when a few relaxations were given and we had to call them to the school. However, all the parents were not ready. It was only 30 to 40% students who were allowed to come to the school. So again, we had to find the ways to arrange both offline and online mode. So again, we had to work on the blended methodology. So what I'm trying to convey is that, you know, as leaders, we had to be flexible. Flexibility was the key in the current scenario. Sir has already discussed about the challenges in the fee collection. Yes, every school is facing those challenges. However, with the constant counseling, meeting with the parents and, you know, suggesting them, we gradually moved, you know, better and better. And now we could resolve the issues of collections as well. A lot of support system was given to the students and the teachers, because many a times the books were not available and they were looking for some online support. So we had to create a strong support system sitting at the school. Luckily, I've been working in a school where it's a residential campus and I am 24/7 on the campus. So I could provide that support sitting here to my teachers, to my students, as well as to the parents. Another thing we tried was to break the monotony of these online sessions, let it be Zoom or many other platform. What we did, we organized many intra-school activities. We have a group of, we are a bigger group with 7 schools. So within those 7 schools, we organized some intra-school competitions based on various festivals and themes from time to time. Let it be the Science Day, let it be the social service. So we did a lot of these things. It broke the monotony of online classes. Also, we, you know, always motivate them to participate in a lot of inter-school events, because in Pune, we had a lot of inter-school events which were going on online, and they came out with flying colors in many of these. All this certainly helped us a lot to bring to a different level. Now, coming to the challenges. Yes, every school is facing challenge, and it is up to our leaders. How do we, you know, take it forward? So always there was a team. There were a lot of fellow colleagues, fellow principals. We had a lot of good team building with them, and with their support we try to resolve each other problems and sorted it out. So these are some of my thoughts. I think most of the points have already been covered by the previous speakers. Thank you once again, Nitya, for organizing such thought-provoking.
Thank you for being here today, and thank you for sharing your thoughts. So Mrs. Josephine Anthony, can we hear you speak on the topic, please?
Yeah, good evening to one and all. I am glad to be part of such an, you know, panel discussion. Though we are spread across India, I think all of us went through this such a daunting phase in the academic career. At least I have spent 23 years. This is my 23rd year in, you know, academic field. But I don't think we have seen such an uncertainty where we do not know where we are heading to and when this is going to end. But I would take this, you know, it has been a very good learning phase for all of us, because it gave us to explore a lot of things, I would say. Because otherwise, such a drastic change for teachers to bring about a transformation over a short period of time, I don't think it would have been possible. I mean, I'm sure when the lockdown happened, we were all on our toes, how to put the family in place and then bring the entire school family together and see how we could board everybody in a 15 days to months time and make sure how the lesson plans are going to be segregated, when the number of periods are going to be cramped up, because we could not have such this thing, because government also laid guidelines for primary classes not to have a very longer period of length of teaching hours. So we had to work out schedules in such a way wherein we had to fit the curriculum in place with this kind of setup. So being in international curriculum, I think we were, most of our teachers were okay with the system kind of thing, but teachers were trained to explore other tools because they had to enhance the way the delivery is done. We had to do synchronous, asynchronous learning, as somebody rightly quoted, because it had to be blended learning, because we all parents were not agreeing to certain terms and conditions, or they were having certain problems at their end, as somebody rightly said. So it was not immediately possible. So we were working through day in and day out. Communication was major, you know, thing. I think it must have doubled when it was, I'm sure, physical classes. Academicians would sit for, you know, planners, or for that matter, you know, your academic planning for a shorter period of time. This was happening more often, I feel. You know, we went on to call, no, this might not work. We need to make changes here. We need to make additions, deletions here. So there were a lot of communication between the teacher, with the leadership, sitting and trying to make adjustments here and there with the teachers and the academic coordinators, you know, and then trying to explain the management, this is something that cannot work out, this is something that we need to cut down on, this is something that we need to add on, this is mandatory, you know, to fit in a lot of things and to make tailor-made adjustments here and there. Definitely as a leadership role, I don't think we have seen that kind of a, what would I call, a roller coaster ride in, you know, these years that I've been with the education field, definitely. But I would really appreciate the entire teaching fraternity for this. They took this as a challenge. If they did not come forward, I'm sure we all would have fallen back. We should really applaud them for what they have done. Of course, they needed us from back. I mean, we were there to support them at all times, but still the courage they gave us that, yes, we will lead, you know, let it start and we will lead it. That was something, that communication, that's what I'm saying. We went from, you know, leadership to a parent, leadership to a teacher, leadership to a academic coordinator, leadership to a management. You know, there was a lot of meeting here, there to make them understand why, what, when, how. I think it created a lot of difference in the kind of role that we played in terms of communicating, especially, I feel, you know. And I'm sure as leaders, if I post the same question for so many, you know, personalities sitting here, have you taken care of yourself as leaders? I'm sure I would see a small smile or a shrug on this, you know, shoulder. saying that yes, it's in progress probably, because there is no time for us to even think about ourselves now. It is so much, every time when you go back in the evening and even sit over a cup of coffee, you might suddenly think, oh, I did not finish, or I did not end up informing this particular thing to someone. And you pick up a mobile and immediately make a call or probably WhatsApp that message to the particular team or the particular department that you need to keep them informed about. So it becomes very mandatory that we are constantly thinking that something should not misfire anywhere, because we are not in direct, when you're communicating, there is no disconnect. But when you are, you know, connected from different places, you always want to keep connected so that there is no gap or miss out anywhere. So always there is this question mark running in your hand. Have I communicated? Is there something that I missed out? Is there something that I still, is there a gap that I need to bridge somewhere? So I feel, yeah, definitely, because every other point, I think Mr. Desmond and Mr. Gopal has mostly covered. So I had a couple of them on my plate. So I think they covered it up mostly. So I thought this was something that I wanted. One thing that being a psychology student myself, that we wanted additional to add on for online classes, because as peer interaction is becoming lesser, and also the children, because there are single child in each family, we try to have additional weekly once or weekly twice, we try to add them for empathy classes, wherein, you know, children try to write a gratitude journal where they're, you know, appreciating somebody and trying to, you know, write a note to somebody. So we have a particular booklet that we give out where they keep a note of and send it to the teacher. Those are some things that we try to this thing add in. So this kind of motivates the teacher also, because somewhere they get a note or here and there from there. And so somewhere we try to tweak in here and there just to keep everybody happy. So basically everything at the end to bring the ends together to keep everybody happy. Though there is no physical this thing there, we try to connect each one. That's how we are trying to keep the ends meeting, Nitya.
Thank you, ma'am. That was great. I really like the concept of these empathy classes. Thank you. So moving on to our questions, Dr. Sandeep Khanna. They say a leader is a person who people look up to, or be it for advice or anything. So how difficult does the situation get during a crisis when people still expect the same?
Yeah, it is challenging, certainly it is up to us, you know, to be, as rightly said, that communication is the key. So it has to be the two-way communication. So we had to develop that confidence among the parents, among the teachers, and even the students that you can approach for whatever crisis it can be. So it took time to develop that confidence, but it happened gradually, and I was able to solve most of the problems by understanding and answering the queries, giving the required help at times. That's how we could resolve.
Thank you, sir. So, Mr. Gopal Kaushik, they say true leaders don't make followers, they make more leaders. So what's your take on this, and how do you think that can be made possible?
If I ask my journey, I've worked mostly in a boarding residential school maximum. I still remember we were empowered at a different time, at a different place. We were given a responsibility to grow. We learned a lot. And I think we adopted that, and somehow we could do a bit good also. Similar practices, it's a culture of a boarding schools, a similar culture we are just applying here also. I do agree with this statement, like we need to produce leaders, give them responsibility, trust them. Trust is also a very important part. Trust them, help them, motivate them, guide them. Definitely they turn up a leader. So I was a part of Mayo College, Ajmer, where I still remember Mayo is known for the good leaders. The good principles. So likewise, this statement is truly said, we need to empower people and we need to trust them. We need to provide them the support, and definitely they are the future leaders, and our education system needs the trained leaders.
Absolutely, sir. I agree with you. Thank you. Mr. A.S. Gadwar, how would you define a great leader?
So in my opinion, the great leader is one who always lead by example. As Ms. Antony said, that what about us? We never thought about us. It was always in our mind that how our teachers are doing and how our students will be doing for their better future. So great leader, they have to always lead by the example. They have to come at the front and they must show the path, especially at this time of pandemic, when everyone, each and everyone, all the stakeholders, they look up to the leader.
Thank you, sir. Mrs. Josephine, what is the one quality you think that every dynamic leader is incomplete without?
I suppose being accommodative. See, everybody that you work with will have some quality or the other. It is all about you finding it and sharpening that and grilling the person in that particular area and bringing them back properly. That is what I feel, you know, every leader should this thing. Everybody will have positives and negatives with them, but it's about looking at the positive side and then polishing them and bringing up there. So I think you should have the right aptitude to look at the particular person that we are with. Yeah.
Thank you, ma'am. Mr. Desmond, so I'd like to ask you, you spoke about the importance of addressing the emotional needs of students, right? So how did you address the emotional needs of teachers during the pandemic? That's where leadership comes into play.
This is a very important and pertinent question. While we were formulating policies for student emotional support, we also had our counselors having open phone line to teachers. So teachers could reach out to the counselors if they had any issue or challenge. As the leader, I was always ready to hear any teacher if they had any kind of difficulty. I have several coordinators. So we were all there as a team to support our staff. We knew exactly what was running through a teacher's mind. In fact, to help during this pandemic, even I took teaching. So this made me understand the various challenges teachers were facing. It was not at all easy teaching online. The amount of preparation that goes in, the amount of time spent in assessment, in giving feedbacks, is phenomenal. So I knew exactly that teachers would be facing a lot of burnouts. And we as a team, with the help of the counselors, were always there. We also had like birthday wishes for staff, you know. So during the month, we organized a Zoom meeting. We wished all the teachers. So we had a lot of friendly interactions also. So that is how we helped our teachers. Thank you.
Thank you. And thank you to all of you for being here today. It was a very nice discussion.
Thank you for having us
and nice meeting all of you on the virtual session.
And with that, we come to the end of this insightful panel discussion on redefining school leadership during the pandemic, where our panelists spoke about the challenges that they faced during the pandemic and how each of them proved to be an efficient leader. Due to time constraints, we can only take a few questions. But if you have any additional queries, do get in touch with us and we'd be glad to answer your questions offline. For more such videos, do log on to our website, theann.com, and don't forget to like, share, comment, and subscribe to our channel. For now, signing off, Nitya.